Okay. Hello, guys. Thank you very much for coming to our session, implementing fine-grained and pluggable container resource management, leveraging NRI. My name is He Cao. I'm a senior software engineer at ByteDance. I'm also a maintainer of the Catalyst project. The other speaker is my friend Qiang Ren. He is a cloud software engineer at Intel. Unfortunately, he couldn't join us here in person today. So he will be delivering the second part of the presentation remotely. First, I will give an overall introduction of the Catalyst project. In the second part, I will delve into the plugin-based resource management mechanism of Catalyst, focusing on the evolution of the QoS resource manager within Kubernetes to the out-of-band resource manager framework, which has been decoupled from Kubernetes. In the second half, Qiang will cover the NRI mechanism and its application in Catalyst. Finally, we will introduce the Catalyst and the NRI communities. First, I will start by introducing the challenges we faced during capacity planning. From this figure, you can see that the resource utilization of online services exhibits a tidal pattern with very low utilization during the night, which is to huge waste of resources. Through an analysis of different types of workloads within ByteDance, we found that online services use CPU intensively and prioritize RPC latency, while batch jobs use memory extensively and prioritize throughput. That's to say, the resource utilization patterns of online services and batch jobs are inherently complementary. Therefore, it naturally led us to consider co-locating online services and batch jobs to improve daily resource utilization. Practicing co-location requires fine-grained resource management capabilities. Therefore, we have incubated a resource management system called Catalyst. The name Catalyst is derived from the word catalyst in chemical reactions, and the K symbolizes its ability to provide enhanced resource management capabilities for all workloads running within the Kubernetes ecosystem. In the second part, I will delve into the plugin-based resource management mechanism of Catalyst. In the previous section, we discussed the co-location. If online services and batch jobs are deployed on a same node, there may be mutual interference between them. So the first step we need to take is to classify different types of workloads into various QoS classes. From this table, you can see that we have four extended QoS classes. The first one is dedicated cores, which means it has exclusive access to some CPU cores and doesn't share them with others. This QoS class is suitable for some extremely latency sensitive workloads such as advertisement, search, and recommendation services. The second one is shared cores. Workloads with this QoS class will run in a shared CPU pool. This QoS class is suitable for workloads that can tolerate a certain degree of CPU throttling and mutual interference, such as microservices. For shared cores and dedicated cores workloads, we also provide NUMA affinity to provide better performance. The third one is reclaimed cores. Workloads with this QoS class will use overcommitted resources. The resource quality is relatively unguaranteed and the pods may be evicted. So this QoS class is suitable for workloads that are not sensitive to latency and prioritize throughput, such as model training and batch jobs. The last one is system calls. It is suitable for some critical system agents like CNI, CSI, etc. Through these four extended QoS classes, Catalyst provides fine-grained resource management capabilities for different types of workloads. However, the native policies of CPU manager and the memory manager in Kubernetes are too simple, and Kubernetes doesn't offer an extension mechanism. Therefore, inspired by the design of Device Manager, we introduced a QoS resource manager framework within Kubernetes. This framework is also abbreviated as QRM. It replaces CPU manager and the memory manager by providing an extension mechanism with some plugins to extend the allocation policies of CPU and the memory. Additionally, we also register QRM as a hidden provider of the topology manager, leveraging topology manager to achieve Newman affinity. Besides the customized resource allocation strategies during container creation, it's also necessary to dynamically adjust the resource allocations for pods while they are running. So we have QRM periodically invoke container runtime to implement resource adjustments. However, during the adoption of Catalyst, we found some limitations with the QRM framework. You can see from this figure, the QRM framework has introduced some intrusive modifications into Kubernetes. That's to say, users need to use Catalyst in conjunction with the KubeWharf Kubernetes distribution. This approach is not user-friendly and makes the Kubernetes code hard to maintain. To address this, we refactored Catalyst recently by decoupling the QRM framework from Kubernetes and introduced a new solution, out-of-band resource manager, or ORM for short. From this figure, you can see that we have removed the QRM module from Kubernetes and have introduced a new ORM module in Catalyst agent. Unlike QRM, ORM supports two modes, the NRI mode and the bypass mode. For the first one, we have implemented an NRI server within ORM, which is periodically invoked by container D when certain container lifecycle events happen, such as run pod sandbox, create a container, remove pod sandbox, etc. It allows the injection of resource allocation policies. For users with older variants of container D, we also offer a bypass mode. The ORM will periodically update container C group configurations. In terms of Newman affinity, since QRM is decoupled from Kubernetes, we cannot leverage topology manager anymore. Therefore, we implemented an out-of-band topology manager within ORM. Additionally, after decoupling, the response data of Kubernetes pod resources API is no longer accurate. So we have also implemented an out-of-band pod resources server within ORM. Modules like Reporter can obtain accurate CPU and memory allocations from the out-of-band pod resources API and report them to the KCNR CRD for the awareness of the scheduler. Next, let's welcome Qiang to share the second half of the presentation.
Okay, thanks, Sahe. I'm Zhen Qiang from Intel, and now I will introduce the third part, the NRI mechanism. Before introducing the NRI, let's first look at some common used methods for enhancing Kubernetes resource management. The left chart shows the default Kubernetes workflow. When we create a pod, the kubelet will call the CI runtime via CI request. And then the CI runtime will call the OCI runtime to create the container. On the right, I have summarized three common Kubernetes enhancement strategies. The first category is called the proxy mode. In this mode, a proxy component is added between the kubelet and the CI runtime. This proxy component intercepts necessary pod or container lifecycle events and perform fine-grained resource allocation for containers. The modified container spec is then sent to the CI runtime to create a container. The modification of the containers in this mode is synchronous, but it disrupts the original Kubernetes workflow. The second method is called bypass mode. This mode does not require any modification to Kubernetes components. An agent is run on every work node to monitor pod event. The pod event can be pulled from the Kubernetes API, or the pod event can be obtained through the cgroup file system by Linux iNotify. And then, the container update can be made by directly modifying the cgroup file system or calling the CI runtime interface. The container modification in this mode is asynchronous, meaning resources are relocated after the container is created, which leads to a certain delay. The third method is to enhance the kubelet. The Catalyst QIM architecture is an example of this approach. The kubelet uses a plugin mechanism to call extensible plugins for resource allocation. And this method updates container resources in real time, achieving synchronous modification of pod resources. However, this mode requires a specific kubelet distribution. As Sohe mentioned earlier, using the QIM architecture requires the kubelet of KubeWolf distribution. Currently, all these three strategies have certain issues. The other require modification to Kubernetes original workflow or components, make it impossible to use the upstream version directly. All these have poor real-time performance, such as KISS2. After understanding the common resource management enhancing strategies in Kubernetes, let's take a look at what NRI is. NRI stands for Node Resource Interface. It is a fine-grained node resource management solution that Intel has helped initiate and actively promote. NRI is available in Kotlin from 1.7.0 as well as in the latest version of Cryo. NRI is a framework for managing CI runtime plugins. You can see this chart. is Kubernetes enhancement workflow based on NRI. The red part in this diagram represents the NRI components. NRI mainly consists of two parts, the adaptation. The adaptation is integrated within the CRI runtime. And another part is the user-defined NRI plugins. The adaptation and the plugins communicate through a Unix circuit. NRI provides a basic mechanism for extension plugins to check container state and make limited modification to their configurations. NRI covers almost all lifecycle events of pod and containers. The main modification NRI makes to container includes three aspects, annotation, environment variables, and system resources. Additionally, NRI plugins are runtime agnostic, meaning that plugins developed based on NRI can be used with both containerd and cryo. Okay, after understanding the basic concept of NRI, let's take a look at the NRI plugins. NRI plugins have two modes of operation. One way is for NRI plugins to run as an independent process, communicating with CI runtime through NRI circuit. In this case, the NRI plugin can be deployed as a daemon set, making it easier to be managed on Kubernetes. The other way is to place NRI plugin binary files in a designated path of containerd. This path can be configured in the containerd configurations, where containerd will initiate the call to NRI plugins. This approach is somewhat similar to the CNI mechanism. However, this method has a limitation. Containerd will only attempt to load the NRI plugins from the designated path during startup. So if you have any changes to NRI plugins binaries, you need to restart the containerd service to reload the NRI plugins. Next, let's look at the lifecycle events that NRI can hook into. NRI can hook into three pod lifecycle events, run pod sandbox, stop pod sandbox, and remove pod sandbox, and eight container events. By this, you can do what you want at the right hook point. In addition to obtaining container events through hooks, NRI also provide a function called update container that can be used to actively update containers. Having introduced the basic mechanism of NRI, let's now take a closer look at how NRI is used in Catalyst. In Catalyst, NRI is primarily used to enhance the ORM architecture. In this new architecture, the Catalyst agent acts as an NRI plugin, receiving pod or container event from the containerd. Within ORM, we use three NRI hook functions. The first one is run pod sandbox. In this event, we attempt to perform fine-grained resource allocation for the current pod. The allocated resources are stored in a cache. And then, in next event, create container, we retrieve the pre-allocated resource for current container from the cache. And the necessary resource adjustments are returned to the containerd. And the container will be created based on the adjusted specifications. And the last one is remove pod sandbox. At this stage, we perform resource reclamations and clean up for the pod. As shown in the architecture diagram, in addition to use NRI in ORM architecture, we also use the bypass mode. This mode is mainly adapted to the low version of Ctrl D in some legacy R environments. In this OIM architecture, we also use the QIM plugin mechanism to reduce the migration cost from QIM to OIM architecture. Additionally, currently it's not only updated resources during pod creation, but also dynamically updated container resources at runtime based on the node resource situation. Previously, Catalyst used its own use case, which required compatibility with different versions of C groups. By using AI, container resource updates can be implemented through the AI update container interface, which helps reduce maintenance cost. In the latest Catalyst release, AI have already been integrated. I will show a short demo. With AI, we can directly deploy Catalyst based on the upstream Kubernetes components. In the right plane, I will show the Catalyst agent log in real time. And in left plane, we execute a bound to deploy a pod and specify the corresponding resource pool of Catalyst. We use the shared core policy here. The moment we execute the kubectl apply command, and the Catalyst agent can synchronously receive the pod event and allocate resource to the pod. You can see here, the first event is run pod sandbox. We allocated the resource for the pod here. In this demo, we have only used the CPU and memory plugins. And the next event is create container. We update the container spec and return to the container D. And then the container D will create the container based on the adjusted specification. Finally, we can check the pod file, the pod C group file system to make sure the configuration is effective. Now we can see the CPU set CPU and CPU set members. This match the shared core policy. The last part, let's introduce the Catalyst and the AI communities. First, let me introduce the AI.
Hey, hello, Qiang. Your network is no good.
Intel put a lot of resources into promoting the development of AI. To date, AI has gone through several iterations and have already been deployed in production.
Hello, Yun Qiang. Your network is not good. Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, hello, Qiang. Yeah, I will introduce the next part.
In addition to
I'm sorry, yeah, I will introduce the next part, yeah. You can find the GitHub repositories of Cataghost and the NRI framework and some useful NRI plugins from these links. And also, we also host Cataghost community meetings bi-weekly. On Thursday evenings. Yeah, you can find the meeting notes and the agenda from this link. Yeah, by the way, you can also scan this QR code to join the Cataghost community group. We welcome everyone to participate in the community contributions. Yeah, if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us for discussion. Yeah, you can also scan this QR code to find the NRI and the NRI plugins repositories. Last but not least, welcome to the KubiWarf booth at S12. Thank you very much. Please feel free to ask questions in Mandarin. Okay, do you have any questions? Okay, yeah, hello.
Catalyst 的话，它其实对于 resource 这层做了一个什么样的管理？然后最终需要，就是我其实对于那个最终达到的效果，因为刚才 demo 看不大清楚嘛，那知道最终达到是一个什么样的效果？好的，对，非常好的问题啊，就是
Catalyst 它是一个精细化的一个资源管理系统，然后我们有很多的应用场景，对比方说可能最初的一个。 最主要的一个应用场景就是在离线混布，对，然后后面呢，我们其实也扩展了一些其他的应用场景，就比方说，像比方说，如果你有在线业务的话，我们也可以把这个节点的资源做一些超分，然后如果可能这些 pod 都申请了很多资源，但是其实没有用到这么多资源的话，它也可以调度更多的 pod 到这个节点上，然后去提高资源利用率，然后还有一些像。 就是比方说 pod 规格的推荐，然后以及一些智能的 HPA， 然后还有就是像一些资源画像呀等等 AI 在系统这一块的一些应用，对，然后可能我们回到最初的这个就是最主要就在离线混布的场景呢，其实我们用 Cataghost， 然后以及用 NRI 做什么呢？其实这种就是宏观来讲，我们就是把 在线这些微服务的 pod， 然后和离线这些训练呀或者大数据的这样一些作业的 pod， 然后他们混跑在一个节点上，然后这样的话就难免可能会遇到一些问题，就比方说他们之间的一些相互的争抢，然后为了确保不同的业务他们的 SLO， 然后我们其实把这些业务分为了四种，对，然后就刚刚这里有介绍到有 dedicated cores 就是那个。 独占核的，然后就是我们一些特别重要的，像搜索、广告推荐这样的一些对性能要求，就是非常高、极度敏感的这样一些业务，还有一些 shared cores， 然后它就是共享一个 CPU 池子，对，然后它的话就是适合我们一些像微服务这样一些业务，然后 requirement cores 其实就是我们用来跑那个离线业务的，它用的是一些超卖然后回收上来的这样一些资源。 对，然后实现一个效果就是，当这些不同类型的业务跑在混跑在一个节点上的时候，然后他们之间的相互干扰，然后会得到一个最大程度的一个减小，然后去保证 ，OK， 然后去保证那个不同业务他们的一个 SLO， 对，然后NRI 在这其中，有什么作用呢 ？OK， 翻一下页。 对，就是我们刚刚有讲到，就是因为有更精细化的这样一些资源管理的策略，我们势必要去找一个 扩展点，找一个 hook 点去注入这些策略。然后我们最初的选择就是去修改 Kubelet， 在这个里面就是借鉴 Device Manager 引入这样一个插件化的这样一个框架，然后去扩展 CPU 内存他们的一些分配策略。对，然后后来我们就是因为这样侵入比较大嘛，所以我们把它解耦出来了。解耦出来之后，这个 ORM 的框架，然后我们就用到了NRI 它提供了一个原生的一个资源的一个注入机制，就是当这样一些容器的生命周期事件发生的时候，它就会回调到靠到我们的这样一个 ORM， 然后去触发这样一些 plugin 中它一个更精细化，我们一个定制化的一个资源分配的策略，然后从而体现在 C group 啊等等这样一些配置上面。对，就大概是这样一个做的这样一个事情。OK， 不知道就是有没有解答你的问题？
本身那个 service 它会有这种比如说 peak hour 嘛，比如说你可能是在每个某些时间节点，比如说晚上的时候，对吧？
嗯，
它可能会有很多的那个 pod 起来啊什么这样、
嗯、
它会对那个就是它其实对服务的那个性能的要求可能会随着时间节点的不同也会有些改变嘛。那如果是这种场景的话，那这边你们是会用什么策略来解决这种问题呢？
嗯 OK， 对，其实这张图里讲的就是这个在线的这种微服务，然后它随着时间的变化会有这样一个天级的一个潮汐现象。对，就比方说可能白天的时候，就是像抖音啊像 TikTok 这样一些应用，它的用户数会比较多，然后它的对资源消耗也非常大，然后晚上的时候因为用户数比较少，所以这个资源消耗也比较低。然后我们其实有两种策略，然后最初的话我们是用到了一个潮汐混布这样一个模式。对，潮汐混布它和我们今天讲的这个在离线常态混布它的区别在哪里呢？就是它是通过 pod 的扩缩，然后去复用充分利用这部分资源做一个削峰填谷。对，或者更具体点来讲，就是夜晚的时候我们通过一些 HPA 的策略，然后会把在线的微服务的副本数给它缩下来，然后像我们的一些大数据啊或者离线训练一些框架，然后在这个时候也会感知到会有更多的一些资源供给，这个时候它会把这个作业的副本数给扩出来，从而去加速一些弹性训练。对，然后等到就是到白天的时候，然后它会把那个离线业务再给缩回去，然后在线业务再扩出来。对，然后这个是我们第一阶段的这样一种混布的模式。这种模式呢其实也会有一些问题，就是比方说可能白天的时候离线的退场可能不是那么及时的，然后如果这个时候我们来一个在线的一个业务的一个高峰期，一个 burst 一个突增，其实它的在线业务的一个 SLO 就不能得到满足。对，然后所以我们后来演化到了第二个阶段，就是在离线的常态混布，就是我们其实不会把在线业务的 pod 它的副本数缩下来，不会让它去离场，然后我们其实会把它没有用到的这部分资源给超卖出来，然后提供给离线业务去用。然后这个时候呢就我们刚刚提到这种模式呢其实对精细化资源管理具有更多的一些诉求，所以我们也引入了不同的一些 QoS 的级别，然后以及对应的一些精细化的定制化的一些资源分配以及调整的算法。对，就大概是这样子。好，嗯，不客气。哎，哈哥。哦，对，这也是一个很好的问题。对，其实我们最初在开源这个项目的时候，我们是基于那个 K8S 1.24 这个版本去开源的。然后对，然后在我们内部的一些应用上，其实我们不只有 1.24 版本的 K8S 集群，然后我们也有那个 1.26 版本的，然后以及 1.28 版本的，还有或者甚至更新版本的或者更低版本的都有。对，然后我们都是其实都经过测试，然后都是可以运行的。对，这里其实和今天这个议题有一个比较相关的点，就是我们原来这种 QRM 的模式，因为去侵入修改 Kubelet， 所以其实对 K8S 的不同版本的支持就会比较困难，甚至说如果我们现在支持一个新版本的 K8S， 我们要往里面去 merge 很多很多行的代码，然后这也是一个非常复杂的工作，所以我们后来就做了这样一个解耦的事情。对对对，然后现在解耦之后呢，其实对 K8S 版本就没有特别的要求了。嗯，支持的，就是其实从这张图里刚刚可能没有展开啊，就是我们在 Kataxis Agent 里面，然后也有一个模块叫 C Group Manager， 它其实就封装了对底层 C Group 的各种操作，然后它的话就它是一个，因为是一个定义的接口嘛，有很多实现，比方说 C Group V1 V2， 然后不同的 C Group Driver， 比方说 C Group FS 或者 SystemD， 然后它的对接都在这里面封装了。然后那个如果是NRI mode 的话，其实那个 ContainerD 在这里面，它那个也都把不同的一些 C group 的实现都给封装了。
OK， 它是好吧，那我们下面再
讲。嗯，好好，谢谢。
谢谢。
OK， 还有一分钟，大家还有其他问题吗？好，如果没有的话，我们今天就先到这里。然后谢谢大家，也欢迎大家下来交流。